This video is sponsored by Skillshare, which is a place where you can learn basically any skill set for less than $10. More on that later in the video. As you look at this photo, there's probably a few things that stand out to you. I notice the Milky Way. It's big, it's bright, and it sweeps across the entire sky. I also notice Scorpius, which is a very distinctive pattern in the night sky that looks like a giant hook, and it has a bright red star known as Antares. But there are some other fainter constellations in this photo, and in this video, we're going to explore the constellation known as Corona Australis. It's a very small, faint constellation, but easy to find if you know where to look. Welcome to Learn the Sky. My name is Janine, and I'll be your guide as we explore the night sky together, one constellation at a time. Let's get a broad overview of the constellation known as Corona Australis. It is represented as the Southern Crown, and it's an ancient constellation that has a variety of representations. I was really fascinated to learn about all the different depictions it's had throughout history, and some saw a turtle, other cultures saw an ostrich nest, some saw a boomerang, and legends about Corona Australis definitely appear in ancient Greek and Roman mythologies, but the records of it date far back to the ancient Mesopotamian times. The name Corona Australis is Latin for Southern Crown, and it's classified as a seasonal constellation. So when and where can you see Corona Australis? It can be seen in both hemispheres, and its best visibility is during the month of August, and it's best to look towards the southern part of the sky because it's located right near the teapot asterism. If you do live in the northern hemisphere, you're a little bit more limited with where you can see it. It can be visible at 40 degrees north latitude and lower, and if you live in the southern hemisphere, any latitude that you may live at, you should be able to see this one. And the key to finding it is looking for that teapot asterism. The teapot is part of the constellation known as Sagittarius, and I do have a whole video about it, so be sure to go see that video if you want to learn more. And for me, I always look for this horseshoe, or actually it kind of looks like a boomerang to me. I look for this pattern in the sky, and I'll give you some other tips that will help you to find it as well. Dark skies are preferred when seeking out this constellation because most of the stars are of fourth magnitude. So if you live in areas with high light pollution, it may be challenging to see this constellation. Now we'll take a look at the pattern that Corona Australis makes in the sky. Here we have the official star map that is released by the International Astronomical Union. And for astronomers, these are the official star patterns. But remember, constellations aren't just the patterns in the sky. It's considered everything within this white box. So it's all the stars that are in this particular boundary. And when I'm looking at this specific pattern, there's a few things that stand out to me. First is I notice how big all the other stars are that are surrounding it, and that tells us the brightness of the stars, which is another term that astronomers use for that is magnitude. So the bigger the dot, the brighter the star. And another thing I also noticed is that even though this is the official pattern, when I'm looking at it in the sky, I kind of see more of this boomerang shape, or kind of it almost makes a complete oval, but it's not quite connected here. But so how I see it is a little bit different than the pattern that is shown here. But one key trick I will teach you to find Corona Australis is using Scorpius as well, because the shape right here that the stars make within the pattern is very similar to this shape that Scorpius has at the end of its tail. So let's dive in. We're going to look at some pictures to help you get some practice with finding this constellation. So here I have this beautiful artwork shown of Corona Australis, and over here is a real night sky picture. Now, of course, this is an idealized picture of what the sky is. It's a long exposure photograph, so some stars are coming out more. So the thing that I try to look for is kind of that horseshoe-like pattern or the boomerang pattern, and I'm it's really easy for me to find the teapot because it's located right by the brightest area of the Milky Way. So here is actually, and where we're looking in this area, this is the core of our Milky Way galaxy. So I see right here, that's the teapot, and then Corona Australis is right beneath it. So there I traced out the pattern for you, and that is where the teapot is. So if you can find the teapot, you can definitely find Corona Australis. Here we have just another picture to show you. We're just kind of zooming out here a little bit more. Hopefully you're able to see the teapot. And if we were to point it out, that is where it is. And remember, the teapot is an asterism. And an asterism is also known as a false constellation. It's not a true constellation, but it could be a pattern within a larger pattern, or it could be a connection with brighter stars. I do have multiple videos about asterisms, so go ahead and see that video. And there is where Corona Australis is. So let's take a look at some other pictures and see if you're able to identify it. So here we have, I like this picture because this is a little bit more realistic, a picture of what you would see outside. So first things first is, can you find the teapot? And if you can find the teapot, if you're struggling to find it, look for the Milky Way and look where the Milky Way is the brightest. And from there, you should be able to find the teapot. Once you find the teapot, look beneath it. It is kind of towards the lower half, lower middle of this photograph. And if we were to point it out, if we put these pictures side by side, there you can see the teapot. Sometimes I think of the Milky Way as like the steam coming out of the teapot. So that's kind of something that helps me remember where it is. And then we're not seeing the full constellation, but right there is where you can see Corona Australis. So like I said, this is one that's really easy to see. Let's get some more practice. So I love this photo, one, because it's by the ocean and I love it. And the moon is standing out. How do I know it's the moon and not a planet? Well, because of the reflection right here on the surface of the water. And then this definitely here is a planet. So the position of these two tell me that Sagittarius is nearby, also the teapot, because Sagittarius is a zodiacal constellation, which means that the moon, the sun, and the planets travel through this particular constellation. So are you able to find the teapot? Here is where it is. Okay, there's the handle. Here's the spout. The Milky Way is not as bright here, probably because the moon is here, but it's also during sunset. So here is the teapot, and hopefully you can see that boomerang shape right by the horizon. So again, just more tips and tricks to help you find this constellation. Before we move on, I would like to tell you more about the sponsor for this video, Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with a wide variety of tutorials. These are video-based quality lessons that can teach you anything from photography to business skills to cooking or even animation. And they're really good practical courses. And even though I'm a professional educator, I'm also a major believer that you can acquire any type of skill on your own outside of a formal environment. So there's a link in my description, and the first 1,000 people to use the link will get 1 month free trial of Skillshare. And it's a really great deal. So go click the link and take a course. For me personally, I've been using Skillshare to learn how to grow the social media aspect of my business. There is a course by Kat Coquelet on social media marketing, and this course was really well done, and it was helpful for me and my team to learn about each social media platform, its user base, and how we can be more successful and find more growth on each platform. And we've already been seeing positive results. So I highly encourage each and every one of you, check out the link below and know that self-growth is achievable through Skillshare. I've got a few more pictures I'd like to share with you. This is the original one that I started out with this video. So again, find the Milky Way, find the spot that's the brightest, and from there you should be finding the teapot. Once you find the teapot, you want to look for Corona Australis. And to me, it's very obvious in this photo. So I will point out that's where the teapot is. And then here is where that boomerang shape is. And another thing that I notice as I observe and study these pictures is that the shape of this constellation is very similar to the shape that you see in the tail of the scorpion. So that's just another tip that you can use to help you find Corona Australis. I've got one more picture for you to help you just get some more practice with how to find Corona Australis. And I use this photo all the time because it shows a lot of the summer sky for me. And again, I live in the Northern Hemisphere. So when I look at this picture, this is what the summer sky would look like for me. If you live in the Southern Hemisphere, this would be the winter sky because the seasons are opposite. But we can see these during the same time of year. So on one side, on the left side of this photo, you can see the summer triangle. You can connect those three bright stars, and that makes up the asterism known as the summer triangle. I've got a whole video about that, so go see it. On the right side, I can see the Milky Way where it's brightest. I can also see Scorpius, and then again, I can see where the teapot is. Once I find Scorpius in the teapot, I can easily point out where Corona Australis. I almost said Corona Borealis. That's the one I'm most familiar with, so I'm not surprised I made that mistake. But right here is where Corona Australis is. So again, that horseshoe or boomerang type shape. And if we were to point out everything, this is where Corona Australis is. But then we also have Scorpius. Ophiuchus makes an appearance here as well. Libra is here. So I love this photo because it just gives us a great view of what's going on in the sky. In the next section of our video, we'll review over the celestial objects that you can find in Corona Australis. There aren't very many objects, but the few that are in this constellation are really interesting. However, you definitely would need magnification to see some of the objects. The two that I'm going to focus in on with this video is the globular cluster, known as NGC 6541, and this interesting area, which includes a reflection nebula, an absorption nebula, a globular cluster, and a variable star. So let's go ahead and dig in. We'll start with NGC 6541. This is a globular star cluster that's located 22,000 light years away. It's about 100 light years in diameter, and its age is estimated to be 14 billion years old. It is of 6 magnitude, which means that you can see it with the naked eye, but definitely dark skies would help if you do want to see this constellation. The naked eye limit for magnitude is 6 magnitude, so it is something that you can see, but if you have a pair of binoculars or a telescope, it would help you in order to see this particular star cluster. But the next one I want to talk about is very interesting. And this area is known as the Corona Australis Molecular Cloud. And it's a star-forming dusty nebula in which has both a reflection and emission nebula. There's also a variable star that's kind of cocooned inside here that's called R Coronae Australis, and this is a variable star. And what is a variable star? It's one in which its brightness changes over time. So I've got some other pictures of this, and keep in mind, this is not something that you would really be able to see. All these photos that I'm showing you are long exposure photographs worth of hours of data in which you stack the photos, so these areas are able to show up. But as we're looking at this, let's go through and point out what exactly is going on here. So I have the full picture, I removed the title, and these are all the areas we'll talk about. So what stands out to me is kind of this dark area, and this is an absorption nebula. And that means that light cannot penetrate through this area of gas and dust. So therefore, it's kind of like absorbing that light that would pass through it. And then here, right there, that area I pointed out, that is the variable star, R Coronae Australis. Then you can see the reflection nebula. So this star is kind of brightening up all the gas and dust in this area. And then finally, we have another globular cluster, and this one is known as NGC 6723. So this one kind of took me a while to interpret and understand everything that's going on. And I do have another map here that just shows you kind of the layers of what is happening. So we kind of really focused in on this particular area. So again, if you want to see this, it's something that you would need special equipment to do with astrophotography and combining exposures as you're looking at the sky throughout the area. So this was so good. In this section of the video, we'll review over some of the mythologies that are connected to Corona Australis. However, keep in mind that the mythologies of the stars and constellations really vary according to the time period, the place, and the culture. There really is no one true mythology for any constellation. There's just a variety of them, especially for this one. I'm really only going to be scratching the surface and exploring a few of the Greek mythologies, but there's many other cultures out there that saw something other than a wreath of myrtle leaves. So in Greek mythology, Corona Australis is not known as a crown, but as a wreath. And this constellation was closely associated with the myth of Dionysus. Dionysus is the god of wine and many other things as well. And he's often depicted wearing a wreath. And many followers of Dionysus were also seen wearing a wreath. It is also postulated that in Greek mythology that this wreath is connected to Sagittarius, especially since it lies so close to that constellation. Was this wreath on the crown of his head? It's hard to say, but it is also connected with Chiron the Centaur. So when looking at other stories in Greek mythology, it is possible that this constellation is the representation of the wreath that was worn by Chiron the Centaur. And one other story that I found is with how this myrtle wreath came into being. So one story that pertained to Corona Australis is that this crown was placed in the sky by the god Dionysus after retrieving his dead mother from the underworld. This crown was a wreath that was made of myrtle leaves that Dionysus gave to Hades in return for his mother. So again, this is just a small portion of the stories and legends that exist out there, but it's often the stories of the stars that help us connect to not only the past, but the present patterns as well. We've come to the end of our video about Corona Australis, so let's review everything we learned throughout this video. It's best seen in the month of August, looking south, and it can be seen in both the northern and southern hemisphere. If you live in the northern hemisphere, you are limited with which latitude in which you can see it in, mostly from 40 degrees latitude and below. It is classified as a seasonal constellation, and it's also considered to be an ancient constellation and has many variations in many different cultures. The best way to find it is look for the teapot asterism, which I'm pointing out right here. And from there, you want to look for Corona Australis nearby. You can also use the curved tail of Scorpius right there to help you find the southern crown as well. There are some pretty interesting celestial objects here, including Corona Australis molecular cloud, which has a variety of things. It has an emission nebula, reflection nebula, variable star, as well as a globular cluster right next to that. However, you do need special equipment in order to see that. And then there's also NGC 6541, which is another globular cluster that can be seen with the unaided eye. So I wish you luck finding this constellation, and let me know in the comments, have you ever seen this constellation before? Was it easy for you to find? And did you have any other tips and tricks that you can share in how you find this constellation? So thank you so much for watching. I always appreciate your support and your feedback, and keep going outside. And as always, keep looking up.